gentlemen, want to welcome you to an all-new edition of War a Week Radio. Guys, we apologize for the slight technical difficulties and the delay in starting, but we're live on the air now, guys, scheduled for the next hour. Before we introduce the star of the program, we do have to remind everyone that this show is brought to you by FightSaga.com. Guys, for all the latest boxing news, please go visit FightSaga.com on the daily. But, guys, this would not be a Sunday evening without the counsel of five-decade fight trainer, the one and only Mr. James Gogue. James, how the heck are you, brother?
Hey, Joe, I'm doing good. I'm still buzzing from last night on what a fight that was. And, you know, it just gives me renewed hope, Joe, that, hey, we still do have a sport out there, you know, unlike those big mouths that just talk all the time. The prima donnas like Devin Haney and Ryan Garcia and Fat Boy Tank Davis and all them other fucking bitches out there. All they do is talk. But they don't, you know what I mean? When it comes to fighting the best, they don't want to fight the best. They avoid each other like the plague, you know, the little bitches. But, you know, you seen two guys that were willing to put it on the line last night and give the great boxing fans out there and, you know, people that are new to the sport, this is what boxing is about. This is the true essence of boxing, okay? Mano a mano. Who wants it more? Who got the bigger balls? Who has the stronger will to win, okay? And last night you saw how special boxing is when it's at its best, when it's at its purest form, okay? And the biggest fights ain't being made out there on a consistent basis because, you know, you got a lot of big mouth bitches ain't got no balls or reluctant to fight each other. You know, they're businessmen, okay? They're not fighters. These guys are fighters, man. You don't see them talking all that smack on the internet, how much I'm worth and all that bullshit. Fuck you all, you motherfuckers that talk all that shit. I don't want to hear that. You know what I mean? I want to know if you're a fighter or not, not a fucking how much you're worth and all that businessman bullshit talk, okay? This is boxing, okay? Okay, I want to see if you're a fighter. Last night, these guys showed me that they were fighters. And, oh my God, what a fight it was, Joe.
It was breathtaking. And you know what? Congratulations to Juan Francisco Estrada getting the SD-12, albeit very unpopular to a lot of interested fight fans who are witnessing this spectacle for 12 rounds over the always game future Hall of Fame Roman Chocolatito Gonzalez. I'll say this, Gogi. They made us wait almost 9 years for this rematch. And albeit, you know, of course, it was at a different weight division, but it did not disappoint. Oh, my gosh, it was worth the wait. Gogi, what a breathtaking affair. And like you just stated so well, last night was the very first time in a very long time that I was proud to be a diehard lifer boxing fan. It was breathtaking. It was everything that you want from a big championship fight. But let me go over the syllabus before we move forward. Guys, we're going to pick this apart the only way Coach James Gogue knows how to. We're going to talk about these scorecards. We're going to talk about what both fighters did differently in their second meeting. We're also going to talk about the future of both men. Are we going to get a rubber match, or are we going to see a rubber match between Estrada and Sor Rungvisai? We'll also talk about the very unpopular ringside judge, Carlos Sucre of Florida. 117-111, my word. And we're also going to talk about a potential solution because, Gogi, as you know, and you've scored fights just like I have, fights of this nature are extremely difficult. Like, I was watching the action last night trying to score it because I always do for Fight Saga. And honestly, I did not envy the judges last night. I counted at least four or five swing rounds that could have easily gone either way in which I really didn't want to pick a winner for that round. I wanted to score it even. We'll talk, should judges be encouraged to score more even rounds in fights like this, and is that the solution? We'll also talk about the payout. guys, I think overwhelmingly we can all agree these badasses at super flyweight deserve a pay raise across the board. It's everything that you love about boxing. So let's get right into it. You know, and your big question, and credit to you, Gogi, for your superb analysis. And guys, it's still on YouTube. If you want to see how Gogi wrote it up, the keys to victory for both fighters and Juan Francisco Estrada, he almost seemed to listen to your show, brother. What did Juan Francisco Estrada do to make it a more competitive, closer fight and ultimately get the victory?
Well, like I talked about last week, Joe, number one, there was two tactical errors he had to correct, okay, if he was to be successful, beating Chocolatito. Number one was staying off the ropes, staying out of the corners. Don't be a stationary target like he was the first fight, and let Chocolatito gain that momentum, okay, by letting him put his combinations together, okay? It didn't look good on the, you know. When you do that, Joe, you're on the ropes, stationary target, getting hit, a.k.a. punching bag, Jaime Manguia. It doesn't look good in the judge's eyes, okay? You got to, you know what I mean? You got to stay away from the danger zone, I call it, the ropes and the corners, and keep the fight in the center of the ring, which he did. You seen Joe. I seen him maybe one or two times, three times he got kind of ropes, but he was fighting off the ropes and getting the hell out of there. He just didn't stay there and take punches. You know what I mean? And like a stationary punching bag, he got out of there, took it back at the center of the ring, and, established control again. That, to me, that was number one, okay? He couldn't let, Chocolatitos gain the momentum of the fight, steal those rounds, especially early on, okay? Pretty much, if he did that, he wouldn't have had his hands raised yesterday. But that was the main thing, Joe. Another thing was become more physical, more assertive in his attack. In the first one, he was boxing too much, moving too much. You know, he didn't hold his own. He didn't hold his ground, okay? When Chocolatito, was putting that pressure on him. This time he did. He was putting his combinations together, Joe. What did I say, Joe? In this small weight division, you just don't throw one or two punches. He was putting them together, five, six, seven, eight. That's what you got to do in the smaller weight divisions because they throw, they fight, okay? It's not the heavyweight division where they just throw one or two punches at a time and hug and grab each other and hug. These guys fight. So that's what he did, Joe. He was just more assertive. Especially, you could see in the later rounds when Chocolatito was trying to, come on. He was just standing there, you know what I mean? He was getting hit with a lot of right hands. Then he started adjusting his defense. He started, cross-blocking, taking his right hand and catching it with his, open glove and everything. What you do is a cat. Cross-block is, George Benton teaches that. Old Eddie Futch, all old-school trainers teach that, okay? When you're throwing that right hand, when your opponent's throwing that right hand, just open up your glove like a catcher's mitt and, just slide it across your face and just catch the right hand, with the open palm. And that's what he was doing effectively. Mm-hmm. He was catching that right hand like that and negating Chocolatito's big punch a lot. And, but it was just willingness to stay there and not let Chocolatito back him up, okay? Neutralize that forward pressure by just being more physical, being, assertive in his combinations, okay? That's it, Joe. That was it. It was just, it's just simple, Joe. Fighting, mindset, okay? Not letting this guy dictate the pace of the fight. And he stood there and battled with him. And, like I said, he came out with his hands raised. That was my keys to victory. If he did that, I thought he would win and everything. And, I was spot on that night. Yesterday night.
Yeah, absolutely. And two or three judges saw it that way as well. But I'll tell you what, I'm completely in awe of Roman Gonzalez. At age 33, boy, there was no quitting the little engine that could. It was absolutely incredible. And what's amazing, Gogi, is when you look at punch stats, both men set a record for 115 pounds. throwing over 2,500 punches in 12 rounds.
Oh,
2,529 punches thrown between the both of them. And Estrada had a career high, 1,212 punches thrown. It was absolutely breathtaking. Both men combined to land an astonishing 705 punches throughout 12 rounds. Think about this, Gogi. How many people do you think could actually get hit 350 times?
Jaime Manguia. Alakram Burchell. Those guys are human punching bags, man.
That's what I'm saying, though. It's superhuman. Taking shots like that for 12 rounds in 45 minutes time, right? You're taking
with small gloves.
With 8-ounce gloves. It was absolutely breathtaking, guys, and it's everything that you love about the sport of boxing. So before we get back into it, let me just say congratulations to both gentlemen. Even though one person got the nod from the judges at ringside, both men raised their stock and are going to get a huge pay raise from Eddie Hearn and DAZN if they do fight again later on this year. But congratulations to Juan Francisco Estrada. He raises his record, improves his record to 42 wins, 3 losses, 28 big wins coming by way of knockout. And Roman Gonzalez, boy, he still has a stellar record, 50 wins, 3 losses, 41 big wins coming by way of knockout. And here it is, Gogi. Here comes the big controversy. Scorecards were 115-113 for Roman Gonzalez, negated, overruled by the two judges at ringside who are not from Texas, guys, scoring at 115-113 for Estrada and 117-111 for Estrada. Look, I'll say this. Yeah, 117-111, 9 rounds to 3. Gogi, could you justify scoring 9 rounds for one fighter?
Oh, absolutely not, man. This fight was going down to the last round. You know, during the fight, one thing I like about Twitter nowadays is back in the days, I talked about this, Joe. When you watch fights, you call a few friends up in the business and you talk about while you're watching the fight, you're talking about how it's going on. But now you can get on Twitter and talk to the whole Twitter world, boxing fans and everything. And one thing I was going into the 12th round, I go, hey, this fight is too close.
Yep.
Both fighters are going to have to lay it on the line and give it their all, okay? Whoever wins this round, I thought they would win the fight. And Gonzalez pulled it out. I thought he won the fight, okay? But, man, I'm not a judge, Joe. You know, these judges, you know, this is subjective now, you know what I mean? Everybody has their, their view on when they score a fight, who they think won. And last night was just a perfect example. Carlos Sucre, I never heard of the guy
Carlos
before,
Sucre,
you know what
from
I mean?
Florida.
And,
yep.
Yeah, I never heard of the guy before. And,
This isn't the first time. This isn't the first time he's had a questionable scorecard, which is why he's been temporarily suspended, right?
My question is, how the fuck did he become a judge? Okay.
What I want to know is why would he get
Joe?
Such? Yep. Why would he get such an assignment of this nature in a world class unification bout? This wasn't just a mere title defense. This is for all the marbles, a unification effort. But the WBA suspended Judge Carlos Sucre, who, it wasn't a long time ago before he had a questionable scorecard. What I want to know is how he got this assignment. Nonetheless, though, let's put all of this to rest. Look, every country has questionable judges, right? Not just Texas, guys. For the record, the only judge from Texas scored the bout in favor of Gonzalez, right? The other
Who
two
is that,
judges.
Jesse Reyes?
Yep. The two judges, Sutherland and Sucre, from Florida and Oklahoma, respectively, scored the fight in favor of Juan Francisco Estrada. So let's just make this clear, guys. It's not a product of having a fight in Texas, like Sergio Mora had to say. And I understand where Sergio's coming from. I covered that fight a long time ago. He got jobbed against, oh, my gosh, what was his name? Brian Vetta in San Antonio several years ago. And so he still has a bad taste in his mouth from that. So that's where that was coming from. He was speaking personally. But, guys, it had nothing to do with the judges at Texas, regardless of what Paulie Malignaggi or Sergio Mora had to say about it. Okay? Let's just get that out of the way. Now, I'll say this, and I've heard a lot of knowledgeable boxing guys cry robbery. Guys, that fight was way too close to call for it to be a robbery either way. Yes, that scorecard was heinous. It was terrible. But, guys, no one should be surprised at the verdict going either way. Like I said, I counted at least, Gogi, four rounds that were swing rounds and that could have gone either way. Whenever you have that many rounds that could go to either fighter, how is it a robbery?
That's a good question, Joe. This fight, you know, to me, and like I said, whoever won that last round, to me, won the fight. To me, it was going, it was that close. And Joe, all those rounds that were so close, hell, man. You know what I did, Joe? I just threw my hands up in there, like, oh, you know, pick, you know, if you pick either one, you know, you can't be wrong. But that's what makes it. That's what is what do you call it? Made this fight. So what do you call it? Thrilling, Joe, because it went down to the last and final round. I knew it was close, Joe. Okay, I'm not in the corner, but you know, I've seen enough fights where I know when it's going to go down to the last round, and whoever wins the round is going to win the fight. And it you know, it did, Chuck.
Yeah,
it did. I thought, you know what? Chocolatito won that damn round, but he lost it and everything. You know what I mean?
Yep.
He lost the fight, but I thought he won the round and everything. So I don't know. Like I said, Joe, it's a in fact, you don't have the scorecards in front of you, Joe. How did the judges score the last round? That's what I would like to know.
Okay, here's – I do have the scorecards in front of me, brother. And look, the last round, the only judge that gave it, round number 12 to Juan Francisco Estrada, was the gentleman who was just suspended by the WBA.
He gave that round of oh, my God. He gave that round to Juan Francisco Estrada?
Yep. Look, I'll say this, though, in his defense, I'll say this. In the nine rounds that he awarded to Juan Francisco Estrada, okay, only two of them were not co-signed by either judge. So seven of those rounds, one of the other judges agreed with him. Okay? That's what happens, guys, when you get a fight that's this competitive.
Ooh.
And when it's back and forth action, right? These are so difficult to score. Look, I'll say this, and this is what a lot of knowledgeable boxing people are not bringing up, and I'm shocked. Because back in the day, Gogi, when we used to have 15-round fights, there were a lot of rounds that these judges would score even rounds. Okay, if you give the rounds that are too close to call, you score them 10-10. Guess what? We're not talking about this at the end of the day. Problem solved. Why aren't sanctioning organizations and state athletic commissions encouraging even rounds in situations of this nature?
I have no idea, Joe. You know, maybe I should, you know, I should talk to, you know, one day, you know, when I get back in this, you know, start fighting in the States again, the big shows, I'll start asking them head commissions like Bob Bennett or Greg Alvarez, you know, how come you can't.
Well,
know,
I regularly do. I regularly do. And I talked about this before the pandemic started, right? And I made this promise to all of our listeners. Boxing, the state athletic commissions, they need good judges, guys who know how to score fights. And so as soon as the pandemic lifts and amateur boxing starts to kick into high gear again, I'm going to actually register and sign up and become an active member of the Texas Department of Licensing and Regulations, and I'm going to lobby to become a ringside judge. And I know I'm going to have to be coached through the process of the amateur level, then the 4, 6, 8-round local markets before I get these assignments. But I'm going to do that because, I'm sorry, boxing deserves better. I know how to score a fight, judge, or a coach. You do as well. So do most of these fighters. What I want to know is, Gogi, why aren't retired prize fighters who know what they're looking at in the ring, why aren't they becoming judges for these state athletic commissions?
They probably don't. They're probably not interested, Joe. Honestly, you know, all you got to do, Joe, if you want to be a judge, you pay your dues in amateurs, okay? You get a few years under the belt, you know, refereeing amateur fights and all that. Like my buddy John Shorley, you know, the good referee from
excellent referee, judge. Yep.
Yeah. Or Mark Calloy, you know,
Mark Calloy also.
He was the president of the South Texas Boxing Association. And he repped a lot, you know, he not only repped, but he had judged a lot of amateur fights. So, you know, Shorty, in fact, was a rep for like 10 years in the amateur before he made his move into the pros back in 92. Richard Steele helped him when Mitch Halpern was around. And they both started together. And John, rose through the ranks. And Mark Calloy, you know, just came aboard, I don't know, maybe the last 10 years or so. But yeah, John Shorty, you've been around a long time. And
yep,
you know,
Rafael Ramos is also an excellent referee and judge as well.
Yeah. I mean, you know, like I said, they paid their dues, though, man. I see some judges in Texas. Oh, my God, Joe. Never refereed an amateur fight. Never judged an amateur fight. It's just because who they know in, you know, political circles that got them where they're at. And I'm not talking about because they know Greg Alvarez. I'm talking about, you know, they're, you know, connected to congressmen or, you know, senators, state senators that got them that, you know, that got them in that position and everything. And they have no fucking I can name a few now, but I don't want to tarnish their name. But they have, you know, nice guys, but they have no business. They have no business in, you know, judging fights. They have no fucking clue.
You're right.
You know, they think the guy that goes out there that throws the most punches is the winner. You know.
Oh gosh, or ones who blindly favor the aggressor, even though they're eating a lot of incoming.
I had to put one in check and tell him, hey man, it ain't about just going out there and throwing, you know, punches. You know, I sat down and talked to him. You know, I didn't go scold him, but I told him, man, you know, there's a lot of factors what takes place in judging a fight. And he was like, you know, I was giving him, you know, he was listening. He was like, man, you know, I was giving him an education and everything. You know what I mean, on what it takes to be a ref, you know, a judge and everything. That, you know, the four criteria.
Yep.
You know, strong, you know, look, effect, you know, what is it? Clean punches, effective aggression.
Yep, that's the first. That's the first
ring generalship and defense. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Clean punches, what is it? Effective aggressiveness or
the
ring generalship?
The primary scoring criteria, Gogi, and let's go through with it for the fans,
80%.
Right? Primary scoring criteria. The first thing that you look at is clean, effective, and consequential punches. There's the subjective part of it. You have to deem whether or not these punches have a consequence, right? And if you can't determine who wins the round just by clean, effective, and consequential punching, then you look at the second level of scoring criteria, ring generalship or effective aggression. Who's dictating the pace of the fight? Who's controlling range? Who's controlling the action? And if you can't determine who wins the round by that, well, then you don't need to be in that position. Or you score the round even. Not enough. I'm serious. That's the problem. These judges, they're coached to reward a winner. But if it's too close to call, or if it's not enough action, like a feeling out round in round one, there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to call that round even. Gogi, do you want a round that's too close to call to determine the winner?
I like, you know, honestly, Joe, after what, you know, after last night, if a round's so close to call, hey, just call it an even round. You know what I mean?
That's right. That's what they used to do.
Fair.
Okay, so I've received so many opinions from fans, right? Messages. One calling for open scoring again. Look, Gogi, you know that fans hate open scoring. It takes all of the drama out of the event.
It's not like
the NBA, where if it's a blowout, you already know it's a blowout by the scoreboard, and you see the second stringers start to come in and play. Okay, well, unlike the NBA, you don't have another game to play to make it up, to get your win back. You don't have another game tomorrow. Okay, these fighters, this is like a Super Bowl for each and every time you get in the ring at the championship level. Okay, and nothing sucks the drama out of the event quicker than open scoring. We've tried, WBC tried that for years, and it doesn't work, guys, so get that out of your head. Also, too many people are making a big deal out of this, and Coach, I want you to shed some light on this, because ultimately, you're trying to jockey your horse to the finish line. Too many people are making too much about Juan Francisco Estrada's trainer after round 10, between round 10 and 11, said, hey, you need a knockout to win. Go get this guy. Let your hands go. If he rattles off a combination, you need to immediately get it back. Too many people are pointing to that saying, oh, see, he admitted they knew they were losing the fight. But, Gogi, in reality, you will tell your fighter anything that you think he needs to hear that'll motivate him and bring him across the finish line strong. Please expound on that, because I've heard some ridiculous things said by trainers that absolutely wasn't true, or that they didn't believe, but they thought would get the most out of their fighter when it mattered most.
Yeah. Hey, Joe, 12th round. Hey, man, you're dead tired, especially the pace they were fighting at. So you got to – look, Joe, being tired is mental, okay? You say the right things to the fighter, boom, that fatigue disappears. Okay? All of a sudden they're recharged again, okay? It's, you know, the motivation tactics, okay, Joe? And – every fighter's different. You know, a lot of fighters, you can't tell them that stuff. You know, cat getting in their face and yelling and screaming, and you motherfucker, you do this. And they don't get to that. That turns them off. Okay? you got to know your fighter, and you got to know what buttons to push, okay? All right. You know, his coach, Gonzalez's coach, I guess he knew how to get his buttons pushed, and so did Estrada. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But, hey, Joe, they knew the – hey, you know what, Joe? The fighters, man, they didn't need the fucking coaches to tell them, you know, the fight was close. They knew it was close, okay?
Of course.
The coach just reminded them of that and everything. But
yep.
Yeah, they knew. And hey, Joe, they're world champions, Joe. They know what they got to do to win the fight. They know what, you know, the dope fucking punches. They didn't need their coach screaming in their face, you motherfucker. You got to knock this guy out, okay? You got to throw
him off. One of the most ridiculous things I ever heard from a world-class trainer. Do you remember Victor Valle? Trainer for Jerry Cooney?
Yeah, Jerry Cooney's guy.
Yeah, he used to tell Jerry, hey, bro, this guy's frightened. He's petrified of you. Go get him. He's scared. And in reality, everyone knew that his opponent wasn't scared of him. But he did that to try and get him to open up and let his hands go.
Joe, your mind plays tricks on you, Joe. When you're in that, you know, like I said, you could be tired as hell, man. You come back, but hey, it's just mental, Joe. It's mental. You know, if you know, boom, all of a sudden, you know, you get those the mental triggers in your head. I don't know. They just give you that adrenaline, and then all of a sudden your fatigue disappears. It's just like in a fight, Joe. You know. Fighters hit a wall, man, in a fight. You know, they just hit, you know, boom, they can't do much. But if they're in top shape and they just relax, that second wind will kick in. And that's what, you know, that's what happens in the corner, and Joe. You know what I mean? That second wind will kick in. You just take a few deep breaths and, you know, let your heart rate slow down. And if you're in shape, you'll recover faster. Now, there's a problem. If you're not in shape, man, I don't give a shit. all those cheerleader talks and all those motherfuckers your coach calls you. If you're not in shape, you're not going to get that second win, okay? Forget about it.
Do you remember Teddy Atlas? Do you remember Teddy Atlas when he was training Alexander Pivetkin for a short amount of time? Do you remember when he fought for the WBA regular world title? Teddy Atlas brought a picture of his late father who just passed away. Brought it to ringside. And in the championship rounds, Teddy Atlas brought out the picture and said, "Do it for this guy. Do it for this guy who wanted to be here to see you win a championship." And Pivetkin, boy, that did the trick. He came out and blasted his opponent the final two rounds and won the fight.
Psychological triggers, like I just said, mental triggers in your head. Boom. That mental triggers, psychological triggers that, what do you call it? They destroy those mental blocks of physical fatigue, and you just march on, man. But some of them coaches, man, to me, no names mentioned. They want to be the star, and they want to be the, reason why the fighter won the fight. So they say all this ridiculous bullshit. You know what I mean? If you're a world champion like them guys, Joe, you don't need to be screamed at. Motivated. They know what's up. They know what the stakes are. You know what I mean?
Yep. So guys, look, going back to the point, and Gogi, that's why we love having you on the show, because it's that insight that no one else is talking about. The commentators from DAZN definitely weren't talking about anything like that. Jeez, Gogi, I'm beginning to think that maybe you and I both should pitch to DAZN, the powers that be, and see if we can take over. Me calling play-by-play and you providing color, I think it would be a great boost for their presentation, to be honest with you. As much as I love Sebio, and he's a friend of mine.
You got to watch what you say, man. I'm not into that shit. Fuck that.
Who says you have to watch what you say, brother? Who says?
Nah, I'm not into that. Nah. Look, I could talk on the radio and say what I want to say, but when you're in front of that guy, I talk about that to Raul Marquez. I told Raul Marquez the other day, man, what do they need? Tompkins and what do they need? Barry Tompkins and Steve Farwood and you calling Showbox. Hell, I could do it myself. I was just joking around, though. I could do it myself and save Showtime $50,000 and everything. What the hell? He started laughing. He goes, "It ain't as easy as you think." I go, "Yeah, I know, bro. I was telling him it ain't easy. Yeah. But you're getting on there,
and you're absolutely
on there,
right.
On
you
live
do have
TV,
a producer in your air.
You're calling when you're calling the fight, Joe. It's not as easy as people think. You know what I mean? And Ball does an excellent job. Of course, I've helped him out over the last 20 years, and hauling the identifying, styles and the weaknesses of fighters, identifying strengths and weaknesses, game plans, keys to victory and all that. And, helped him evolve as a broadcaster where when he gets on, TV, it flows. He has that knowledge in his head where, he lets him be him and just call the fight naturally. But just the knowledge and the knowledge I gave him about, like I do here, breaking down fights and all that, strengths and weaknesses, key to victories. But nah, that's me. They're calling a fight. No, because something must slip. You know what I mean? And let's just say one show would be my last show. Okay.
Oh, boy, I can only imagine what you would have to say about some of those undercard bouts.
Yeah, Joe.
Oh, boy.
Joe, you got that. You got, like Raul Marquez told me, you got that earpiece and you got that ear mic in your, you got that earpiece in your ear and that damn fucking, producer or whoever's in the truck, they're telling, you're trying to talk and they're screaming in your ear, man. Why don't you just shut the fuck up and let me do my job? You know what I mean? I would tell him. You know what I mean?
Well,
You want to hear something funny?
I tell you what, it'd be entertaining. Go ahead, Gogi.
There was this one fight, Raul. After we come back, we talk about his show, how it went and all that. One time he just came back, he was pissed off at the producer. And I don't want to mention the producer's name. I don't even want to mention the network because Raw's a machine. He's done it for NBC. He's called fights for NBC, Telemundo. What do you call it? Showtime, Showbox, HBO.
Yep.
You name it, Joe. I mean, he's done it all, man. And but this one time, man, he was pissed off at the producer, man, and him and his co-host, man. That producer kept on, insistently telling them all kinds of bullshit. You know, when they were, you know, they were on air calling the fight, and oh, don't say that. Say this. Don't say that. Oh no, talk about this. You know what I told Raw? Next time he does that, just take the earpiece out and just fucking him, just let it hang. You know what I mean? Yeah. Because, you know, Joe, that's irritating, man. You're trying to call it,
yep.
You know, you want to say stuff. Then he's, you know, he's yelling in your earpiece, telling you what to say.
See, that's one thing I absolutely loved about Emmanuel and just the two-camera system that we had. He let me do whatever I wanted. He let me... because of being coached by him, being coached by you, being coached by Don, all the great guys who I learned from.
You be yourself.
I was able to call the fight action and also provide insight from listening to you guys break down fights, right?
Yeah.
And he trusted me. He said, yeah, you're doing a great job, Joseph. Just keep doing what you're doing. I've had nothing but good things, heard nothing but good things to everyone who tunes in, right? So he trusted me, and he just let me do whatever I needed to do. And I had no complaints.
Joe, you were yourself. You were in a robot. You weren't trying to copy me the way I am. I just gave you information. Emmanuel gave you knowledge. And you gained that knowledge. You understood that knowledge.
Yep.
And when you saw the fights, you see it happen, you explained the way you wanted to. But
trust me,
I can't deal with somebody yelling in my ear.
I knew better than to try and replicate both you and Emmanuel live because, it would have been an F-bomb every other sentence.
Yeah.
You were just like Emmanuel, brother.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
Manuel could control what he says on TV.
Absolutely.
Off the camera, you know how he was.
I tell you what, Gogi, in a conversation, right, outside of off the air, please remind me of this, and I'll tell you some of the names that Emmanuel used to call some of his coworkers on HBO, including Max Kellerman.
Yeah.
Oh, he had a lot of respect for Max Kellerman, but, he couldn't stand him sometimes because Max would often talk over Emmanuel.
Yep.
And I'm going to go ahead and say it because, look, and God bless Emmanuel, and anyone who loves Emmanuel is going to laugh at this. But he said, you know, one thing I can't stand is I can't stand when the Golden Jew talks over me.
He never told me that. Joe, he never told me that, but, he told me that. He voices frustration or sometimes them guys, you know what I mean? Like,
Manny's
the expert, okay? These guys are.
Exactly.
Look, Joe, these guys just study boxing, okay? They're, what do you call it, academics, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Manuel is more than an academic, okay? He's a guy that he gained his knowledge through the University of Hard Knocks, okay?
Indeed. Just like you, Gogi.
Yeah.
Well, tell you what, it's a real joy to be able to work with you guys, man.
I study the sport.
Absolutely. Gogi, while other guys are watching it, you're living it, and that's the difference, brother.
Hey, Joe, look, you don't understand, Joe. I study the sport. I mean, let me tell you this. At one time, I had over 40,000 fights on DVD, VHS. I collected fights, okay? I had a ton of boxing magazines. Read everything I could. News back in the days before internet, I read everything I could on boxing, on boxing books, newsletters, you know, what's going on in the boxing world. I knew every opponent out there, who they fought. If I was learning the levels to this game, like Lou Duva told me a long time ago. But the thing is, I've been in the gym with so many great trainers, especially in Big Bear. You name them, all of them, all the greats. You heard of Eddie Futz, the Benton, to you name it, that Joe Goose and Jesse. I've been in the gym with all them guys. Okay. I've met so many great fighters in the past. I trained in the gym with the best fighters, okay, in Big Bear.
Yep.
Or, you know, they come into my gym training, like Hector Camacho. I've seen them all. I've seen this, that. I learned through experience and everything, but I studied this game religiously, you know, and I knew the opponents. That's why I was Don's go-to guy. He needed what do you think about this guy? What do you think about that guy? Because he knew. Or a guy coming out of the amateurs, okay? I studied the amateurs religiously back then. I knew because I followed the amateurs. I seen them fight, okay? And I tell Don about them, this and that and this and that. But, you know, that's why people, you know, they say, oh, I know a lot. But, you know, it's not only book knowledge because, like I said, I had over close to 40,000 fights. I seen James Tony Joe when he was in the sixth-round stage. When he was coming up, he was raw and green. I couldn't believe it. It ain't the James Tony when he fought Iran Barkley. It's the James Tony when he was fighting a six-rounder in New Orleans when he was just starting off. I'm like, God, dog. But I seen where he was at and what he became, okay, how he grew and evolved. See, all this stuff, Joe, it's not like, you know, I study this. I just don't study on Twitter, okay? I study this,
I'll say this, Gogi. And the great Don Chargan used to always refer to you as the best talent scout in the business. Always.
Oh, Don.
He always.
Don told me all the time, man.
Don always referred to you as the best talent scout in the business. Yep.
Even when Golden Boy was making matches and they would call Don, and Don was, you know, needed some more information, he'd call me up directly. I said, what's this for? I'll give you one example right now. I think Bernard Hopkins was thinking about moving up to heavyweight one time and fighting. I can't remember the heavyweight. I think it was Povetkin. They were just talk. It was just talk. You know,
yep.
Hopkins thinking. I said, Don, that's a big boy, man. And he agreed. You know what I mean? He might have better skills and everything, but that's a big boy. You don't want to mess with that. Plus, that juice freak out. He might be on something when he. But,
yep, absolutely. I tell you what, let's go back to point because we're running out of time. But so, Gogi, guys, look, no one should be crying robbery. And unfortunately, fans, and this is what really pisses me off about fans, right? Rather than heralding the fight action that we saw last night, they're crapping all over it because of the judges at ringside. This is another case where fans have been conditioned. It's almost become a reflex to them. They complain first, think about it later. Okay, stop your bitching. Stop complaining about the beautiful product that we just got last night. It was wonderful. And I tell you what, we're running out of time, but if you had to give your professional opinion, Gogi, what are we going to see next for Estrada? Are we going to see him fight his mandatory in Sorong Visai, which would also be a rubber match? Or are we going to see a rubber match against Chocolatito Gonzalez? In your professional opinion, what do we see next?
Fuck Sorong Visai. This fight's hot, Joe. This rematch is hot.
Sorong
Visai can wait. Okay, that Sorong fight doesn't – it's not. There's not a lot of buzz. Okay, there'll be buzz, but not like this one. This fight's hot. Great, tremendous fight. Probably fight of the year, okay? And controversy, okay? Controversy, like Hall of Fame, you know, promoter Don Chargan always told me, controversy always generates a rematch, okay?
Always.
What I mean? It gets hot. It's a hot fight, Joe. That's what I'm saying. The hot fight
is
a rematch.
Indeed,
with Estrada.
Good or bad, it's currently the talk of the boxing community. So, yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
You roll with the hot matchup. That's what Don would always say. So, I tell you what, congratulations
but
to both fighters.
But, Joe, here's the only thing I would do. Here's what I would do. Put it in, put it in like California, the StubHub Center, the Gladiator Pit. But, you know, then again, you know, you got to see what the COVID restrictions are because of that bitch-ass, that bitch-ass weasel governor don't want to open it up. You know, he got no fucking balls. He's a little weasel bitch. So, you know what I mean?
Well,
but that would be
what,
the perfect place.
Tell you what, next time, yeah, let's just hope, man, we can put it at the StubHub Center. And I don't even know what it's called now, but the Boxing Thunderdome in Southern California, that would be the perfect place. The home of Israel Vasquez and Rafa Marquez. Do you remember those fights?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Breathtaking stuff. But, guys, the boxing fans won last night. So don't crap on this effort. Don't crap on the product. Embrace it. Enjoy it. Let's see a third one. So, Gogi, I'll tell you what, moving on, brother. There was also some action on Showtime last night. Very quickly, your thoughts on David Benavidez, TKO 11, over the surprisingly gallant and hard-headed Ronald Ellis, who went 11 rounds getting the snot beat out of him.
He did what he's expected, Joe. One thing I could get about it, we could get out of this fight, he's not ready for Canelo, Joe. He's got to get more physically stronger, okay? Canelo right now would break him down and probably stop him. So by the time now and by the time he fights Canelo, he's got to make a 110% dedication to his craft and getting physically stronger, getting in better condition. Okay, by staying in the fucking gym, by, you know, by working on his strength and condition when he's not fighting, like right now, or take a week off, and keeping his fucking weight down. That's what he's got to do. He's got to be a pro like Hopkins, 24-7, like, you know, like Marvin Hagler, you know what I mean? He just can't be a half-ass and let his weight blow up to 220, man. He's got to keep his weight under control, at least 20 pounds over 20, that was 68, no more than, 20 pounds or 15 pounds over his, the weight he fights at, okay? But he's got to work, you know, he's got to keep on working to get physically stronger and better condition. Oh, he could fight, Joe. There ain't no question. You see them combinations he was throwing. You know, he ain't scared to go inside and all that. He's long and rangy. You know, he'll give Canelo problems with that jab and everything. But the thing is what happens when he gets close? Now, he has offensive weapons. You know, the combination punching and all that stuff, but he's not physically strong enough, Joe. He's got to get, to me, you know, he's not there yet. You know, he's got to get 30, 40% physically, 50% physically stronger. And you do that on a, you know, by staying in shape between fights. And the main thing is a good physical strength and conditioning program with a good nutrition program will add that physical maturity to him he needs. And then it makes the fight more compelling. And right now, Canelo, I think he's a little bit too much. But, you know, you get this guy physically stronger, let him mature more and grow more. Yeah, then we got a good fight on our hands, Joe. We got a good fight on our hands with Canelo.
Absolutely, and that's pretty much the one most people, even though he doesn't have a major world title right now, that seems to be the one consensus, right, that most, pretty much every fight fan wants to see. So I'll tell you what, going back to our syllabus, though, and I forgot to bring this up, and I really want to get your thoughts on this, Gogi. Even though both competing fighters last night in Dallas, right, even though they both got an increase in pay, considering that their last efforts on DAZN, Gonzalez only received $500,000, Estrada only received $300,000. Now, they got a considerable pay raise from that, but still, if you combine both of their purses, it still doesn't equal what Devin Haney is going to be making for his fight against Jorge Linares, and it's going to be probably one-tenth of the action that we saw last night. Gogi, what has to happen for these guys to start earning what they deserve in pound for pound, the most exciting weight division in boxing?
DAZN, I think Eddie's going to open up the purse, the money for the next fight coming up. Plus the manager's got, you know what, Joe, it's his managers that represent him basically. Hey, man, and the fighters got to step forward. Hey, man, you know, you want the rematch? Give us more money. Okay. They earned it, Joe. They could talk about getting more money, okay? Fuck Haney. Fuck Ryan Garcia. They ain't done shit. Teofimo, he got one good win. Now he thinks he should be paid like Mike Tyson. Fuck him, too. These guys earned that right to ask for more money, okay? So they, you know, they need the fans want the fight, okay? So they know that. So they need to start speaking up. Hey, I want more money. Because it could be their last, I mean, it could be Gonzalez's last fight. Don't forget, man. He's holding the, you know, he's getting up there. So, yeah, if me, fighters pressuring their managers and the managers pressuring Eddie and DAZN, you know, opening their budget, you know what I mean, to, what do you call it, to pay these guys, you know, so it's how they allocate their money, and they're paying the shit, Andre. Fuck Andre. Okay, that once in a lifetime, once a year fighter, if that. Fuck Devin Haney. He ain't done shit. What does he deserve to be a $3 million fighter? Fuck him. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I mean, Joe. You know what I mean? He can't even fucking put two. He's not even proved. He can't even prove to himself. He hasn't even proven to sell 2,000 tickets. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So, you know, fuck him, man. Fuck him. You know, give the money to these guys that earned it. Not that Devin Haney and all these fucking social media, you know, fighters that think they're worth this and that. Fuck them. And, you know, open the budget to these guys, man, because they deserve it. They earned it, Joe. Oh, you know, to me, $1.5 million, $2 million each for the next fight. Yeah, for these guys.
I agree.
Yeah. Yep. But Eddie, you know, Eddie is not the kind of, I don't know the dude, man, but he ain't the type of guy that's like King will try to, you know, pocket all the money. You know, he's more giving, you know, he's more giving than everything, where, you know, he'll accommodate the fighters to make sure they get paid.
Yeah, he's more than fair. And one thing that's the best quality about him as a promoter, he's transparent. He will tell.
He will
sit down with his fighters, and he'll explain to him how it's being distributed, all of the proceeds. He'll actually sit down with his fighters. That is probably the best quality of him as a promoter. That, and he is a great mouthpiece for his fighters. In this era of loudmouth buffoons, he continuously speaks very well on behalf of all of his fighters. He is an excellent mouthpiece for the sport. Tell you what, let's just hope that he continues to grow in America, because this is a step in the right direction, Gogi. But I'll tell you what, one thing I wanted to talk to you about, also in the co-main event of Showtime broadcast last night, one of my favorite prospects, boy, he was in a dreadful fight last night. Isaac Cruz Gonzalez at 135 pounds got a terribly uneventful UD12 over Jose Matias Romero from Argentina. Gogi, if they wanted this guy to look good, they picked the wrong opponent to do it. Talk about what you saw last night for 12 rounds of dread.
Make it real quick, Joe. It was a shit fight. They brought in the wrong opponent, but you know, that Samson Lekowitz, this guy who, you know, who's also the, you know, promoter or manager of David Benavides. And, you know, he uses pull, his leverage, you know, because he had met Benavides in the main event to bring his guy from Argentina to be the opponent for this guy. But that guy, yeah, don't bring him back. Keep him in Argentina. And, that's all I got to say, man. The guy makes terrible fights. He sucks. That's how I describe him.
Yep. So I tell you what, let's just chalk this up as a learning process. Look forward to seeing Isaac Cruz next time around. Gogi, and obviously it was very fitting that we saw both men leave it in the ring last night. Very fitting on the day where we discovered the untimely and tragic passing of the marvelous one, Marvin Hagler. Gogi, talk about what a special man was in and out of the ring. Marvin Hagler was one of a kind.
Hagler was one of my idols coming up when I was a young kid in this sport, young trainer. The epitome of what a professional fighter should be came up the hard way, you know, 54 fights before he got his title shot. Nothing was given to him, okay? Worked, a job in construction, coming up in his career before, you know, he could afford to quit when he started making the big money. He had to fight everybody, Joe. Not like these guys nowadays where, you know, they're cakewalk to a title shot or, you know, or engineered by good matchmakers to win a world title. Not Hagler. No. He had to come up the hard way, fought everybody, never avoided anybody, okay? Everybody he wanted to fight. Everybody he wanted to fight, all the big fighters out there, he never turned them down. He fought them all the number one contenders, all the top fighters. Don't forget, Sugar Ray Leonard avoided him for a long time and waited for him to get old. He did it, you know, that's where Canelo learned from, you know what I mean? Oh, don't fight Golovkin until he gets old, like Sugar Ray Leonard did when he fought Hagler, okay? He didn't fight him in his prime. If he did, he would have got destroyed in a 15-round fight. Leonard wouldn't have won. He would have, you know, he would have got destroyed by Hagler. Okay, but anyway, like I said, Hagler, avoided nobody, man. A true professional, totally like Bernard Hopkins, you know, who Hopkins learned from Hagler how to be a professional. 110% committed to this sport, ferocious. Like Hagler said, you know, he was always working to perfect his craft and everything. You know what I mean? Joe, man, it shocked the hell out of me, man, when I found out he died, man. I met pretty much everybody in boxing. Only two fighters I probably haven't met is Ali, which I got dog, man, you know what I mean? And now Marvin Hagler, you know. But I pretty much met everybody, you know, in boxing, you know, being in the fight business. But I never met Hagler, who I always wanted to meet. I met his trainer. Been on a few road trips, in fact, with his trainer. We were Germany together for a week, and Arkansas, and I think L.A., New York, I think, yeah. So I got to know his trainer pretty good. He told me some great stories about Marvin and everything. You want to hear a story he told me about him?
Let's hear it, brother.
Marvin, he said, you know, Marvin came into the gym. First day, he just watched. Second day, he came back and just watched. Afterwards, the training session was done. He walked up to Marvin. He goes, hey, kid, you want to fight? He goes, you want to learn how to box? He goes, sure. He goes, yeah, I would do. He goes, be here tomorrow. And guess what? Marvin showed up. But you know what he told me about Marvin? That he would learn real fast. He had a short learning curve. See, some guys, man, Joe, God, being a trainer, training guys at all levels, some guys you teach something to, sometimes it'll take 6 months to learn. Some guys just pick it up real fast. Everybody has a different learning curve. You know, it's all talent related, Joe. The more talent you have, and the experience level too. The more experience you have, your learning curve is real short. You'll learn it faster. But he said Marvin, he was surprised on, you know, how fast he would pick stuff up, and you know, and he went up to Marvin one day. He told me, he goes, man, kid, man, you sure getting better. You sure are learning. He goes, oh yeah. He goes, whatever you teach me, I go home in the mirror and practice on the I practice shadow boxing, which you teach me in the mirror when I go home. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Wow.
It was, like I said, what I'm trying to say, Joe, a lot of guys, you know, you teach them in the gym, hell, by the time they're outside of the gym, they forgot what you taught them. They don't do their homework, okay,
Joe?
It's like you're in geometry class. Whatever the teacher teaches you, you know, you get it, but when he gives you a homework assignment, you don't do it. You come back to class the next day. You don't know. You forgot what he taught you. Do your homework, Joe. Whatever your coach teaches you in the gym, you go practice in the mirror shadow boxing. That's one thing I learned from Goody back then when he told me this, that, you know, Marvin always did his homework.
Wow. Yeah, I tell you what, and this is a gentleman who never missed weight. Always loyal to the very end, stayed with his trainer until his last fight. Never ducked anyone. Retired with his health and his wealth intact. He was the epitome of what you want from every single one of our fighters. I'll say this, Gogi, in your professional opinion, what would Marvin Hagler think of today's, this young generation of loudmouths?
Oh, shit, I watched a YouTube video on him, in fact. And he was like, God, geez, these fighters today got it so easy. They're basically, you know, what he was saying, like I've been saying, you know, they're cakewalk to a title fast. They didn't have to go through the hard stuff he had to, you know. Joe, fighters nowadays are cakewalk to be champions. Do good matchmaking, you know. through good matchmaking, they could be engineered the right way to, you know, to win titles. Plus, with all the fucking belts out there, oh my God, if you can't be, if you're a good prospect nowadays and you can't win a good title, if you got a good matchmaker, oh Jesus, I don't know what's wrong. The odds are highly stacked in your favor. And, you know, he was just saying that, you know, the hunger is not there. The toughness is not there. You know what I mean? Everything I talk about, Joe, because, you know, I learned this shit back in the old school days, man. And I what do you call it? Learn old school values of what this sport's about. And Hagler, guys, you know, like I said, Hagler was one of my idols. I learned a lot of these old school values from fighters like him, old type trainers back in the days. But yeah, that's what he was saying. You know, it's pretty much basically, Joe, he was being kind of politically correct, but he could pretty much tell you, if you took him on the side, he would tell you what a joke fucking boxing is. You know what I mean? Oh, he said there's just too many champions out there. You know?
Yep.
You know what I mean? And you don't know who the real champ is nowadays. It's a fucking joke. Yeah. That's what he thinks about boxing.
What do you think Marvin would actually say if a fighter in his era was promoted like Ordeñez Ugas to welterweight champion of the world?
No, he fucking left. Man, you know, Joe, if you grew up the era I did, or you attained old school, you know, fight values, you know.
Mm-hmm.
See, I learned from the old-time greats, fighters, the trainers, and, you know, all that, because I came in the era. You would have the same attitudes. The guys that I grew up in my era had that, you know. Guys like Russell Peltz, okay, Bruce Trampler, Ron Katz, all guys I talk on Twitter right now that, you know, grew up in the olden days, and a lot of stuff I learned from them guys and everything. You know, they think the same way I do. Shit, I bash everybody a lot on Twitter nowadays, man. But, you know what I mean? They know I'm right. They know I'm not lying. You know what I mean?
Yep.
They know I'm
yep.
not talking shit and just spreading my vial. No, they know I'm right and everything, man. Because boxing, like I said, in its purest essence, is what we witnessed last night. Okay, that's what boxing was the norm back in the days, Joe. But now it's an aberration and everything, okay? The best used
yep.
to fight the best all the time. Okay,
yep.
The best wanted to fight the best all the time, you know? They didn't let financial demands or I'm going to be the A side, you're going to be the B side. Hey, fuck you and all that shit and these fighters nowadays that act like a little bitch. They just wanted to fight. You know, the financial demands, they could get it. You know, they let their managers get it done. You know, about the B side and A, like these fucking bitches nowadays. You know, all these little petty women shit these fighters argue about today, they didn't have that shit back in the days, man. They just wanted to fight. And Hagler was one of them and everything. You know what I mean? And
yep.
he was willing to fight anybody, anytime, man. It took Hearns a couple years, man. But Hearns, you know, they were both still in their prime. He didn't do like Canelo, okay, make a love. Canelo gave up his fucking belt. He just said, fuck this. I don't want to fight you, Golovkin. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
He gave his fucking belt. That's why he lost a lot of respect to the Mexican fans. He's not revered like Chavez, okay? No. He ain't revered like all the other great Mexican champions. They would never do that, Joe.
Yep.
We talked about that before on one of the shows. They would never. That was unfathomable. If they're the champion of the world, just to give up their belt because they don't want to face their you know, their top rivalry. That's what Canelo did. But he went, and, you know, that's why everybody talking, you know, Canelo, I like him, man, but that and his PED use, you know, getting caught with PEDs and picking
yep.
fighters, like Eric Morales said this. He only chooses fighters when they get old. I mean, they know it. Eric Morales came up the hard way. He's an old school gladiator. Him and Brewer, they know it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Chavez knows it too, but he's not. You know, Chavez is not going to criticize him like Morales. Yeah.
Yep.
But when he gave up his belt, man, I'm like, man, this guy, fuck his bitch. You know what I mean? Old school Mexican champions, never. That was unheard of, man. He disgraced the Mexican. He disgraced the Mexican warrior. When he did that, the champions of the past just gave up his belt. No, I don't want to fight Golovkin. You can have my belt, okay? You got bigger balls than me, Triple G. I got no levels. Here's my belt. He did that, Joe. Come on. You can't say he didn't.
Well, did he do it, Gogi? Because no, you're absolutely right. I'll say this, Gogi, because we're running
fucking
out of time.
Puto.
Oh my gosh.
Joe, honestly, Joe, I lost respect for the guy when he did that. Okay.
Yeah,
That's not a championship that should be in the Hall of Fame. Just, you know what I mean, Joe.
I'll say this, Gogi, because we're running out of time. But yeah, it's thank you, Estrada, as well as Gonzalez,
yeah,
for giving us a glimpse of what we had grown accustomed to seeing on a regular basis during healthier eras. Thank you for this gift. Thank you for leaving it all in the ring, and thank you for having the stones to want to do it again. Because a lot of these guys, when they encounter a difficult fight and a real challenge in the ring, they seem to want to avoid it at all costs. Thank you for heading toward this challenge head on. And the fans were the true beneficiaries of your efforts. Thank you so much, and we hope to see it once again later this year. God bless you both. I tell you what, Gogi, we're out of time, brother. We didn't even get to preview this weekend's fight action. Would you like to do a segment later on in the week for about 20 minutes previewing the upcoming Virgil Ortiz-Marie Soker fight?
Yeah, we'll say it's a good fight. It's a good regional fight. You got one guy from Dallas and Hooker, and you got another guy from the Fort Worth area, Grand Prairie, Virgil Ortiz, who I know in the amateurs. In fact, Virgil, in the amateurs, they were on the – him and one of my guys, Pablo Ramirez, who was a two-time national Golden Glove champion. They were on the same team, the Texas team, that competed 1 year in Utah. And Virgil lost in the finals. My guy won it that year, too. You know, that was the second one. But Virgil was on the amateur team. And I seen Virgil fight in the amateur. I know I'm very familiar with Virgil. Like I said, just a 15-year-old kid, you know. Like I said, Joe, I studied this shit. I'm not a motherfucking guy that, you know, just runs his mouth. Here's what they do, Joe. They follow some guy on Twitter. Then they think, you know, and that Twitter tells them something. Now they think, you know, that's how they get their information. But
oh,
I know Ortiz pretty damn good, and he's one of the upcoming stars in boxing that you need to keep an eye on. And he's got a very tough task in front of him. Maurice Hooker is not old and shot. He's still got a lot of left in him, and he's trained by Terrence Crawford's training team, led by, you know, B-Mac, Brian McIntyre. So they're going to be ready, Joe. They're going to be ready. But if you want to do a fight predict, yeah, let's do it. We'll do it later in the week. Yeah, why not?
There's several upcoming fights that I'd like to discuss. Also, Arthur Baturbia versus Adam Dienz from Moscow, Russia. I also want to do a breakdown on the schedule. So let's meet up again here on Wednesday, if that's okay with you, Gogi. Wednesday night for 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about
he's fighting.
I'm sorry?
Baturbia, who's the other guy who's fighting?
Adam Dienz, his mandatory challenger.
I never heard of that guy. I never seen him fight. So,
well, you won't after this either, brother.
Okay.
But we'll let you look at some fight tape in case something interests you in the style matchup. But for my money, Gogi, no one is beating Arthur Baturbiev anytime soon at 175 pounds. This guy may be the hardest pound-for-pound puncher in boxing currently.
Yeah.
He's a monster.
Yeah. Incredibly, insanely strong.
Oh, my gosh. It's obscene. It's silly, Gogi. The guy who retired Adonis Stevenson got smoked like a cheap cigar by Baturbiev. That's saying an awful lot. But I'll tell you what, guys, we'll talk more about it on Wednesday night, something to look forward to with Coach Gogi. But, Coach, do you have any parting shots for our listening audience this evening?
No, just thank everybody for tuning in all over the world, especially, you know, we had a lot of fans. We had a good fan base in England, you know, the great fans of England. I always call them, the best pound-for-pound fight fans in the world. And, last night, Joe, it recharged my enthusiasm for the sport. As you know, Joe, I kind of lost a lot of motivation, enthusiasm for the sport because of these bitches, the way they're acting, prima donnas, you know, the best fight, not fighting the best, and, you know, and all the other bullshit. You know, Al Heyman and his, you know, the chief roadblock, what do you call it, the chief roadblock in making big fights in boxing,
yep,
and all that shit. All the negatives. They're, what I'm trying to say, Joe, is like 90% bullshit and only 10% fun. And I lost a lot of interest. But that fight last night, mm-hmm, boy, it kind of like recharged, you know, it recharged my interest. And I hope, you know, the big fights like this keep on continuing, because consistency is the key to growing the sport. Consistency and great fights being made.
Guys, he's James Gogue. You can hear his consistent effort every single week on War Week Radio, but that's going to just about do it, guys. I want to thank you for tuning in. In case you missed any part of the show, you can check it out on our YouTube platform. But, guys, that's going to do it. On behalf of Coach James Gogue, I'm Joseph Herron. You've been listening to War Week Radio Network. Have a great evening, everybody.